Okay, let's think about what's happening here. And it may be easier to think about it in terms of the subspace iteration. What do we have? We have this matrix in which we are computing vectors that eventually lie in the direction of the various eigenvectors. Okay, we call that matrix V hat. But through this exercise you just did, you recognize that this matrix V that we accumulate right here has the same property. Now, if you think back about the analysis of how fast the power method converges, what you notice is that this vector converges to x0, and how fast the component in the direction of all of these other vectors disappears is dictated by the absolute value of lambda 1 divided by lambda 0 when it comes to this component, lambda 2 divided by lambda 0 in absolute value when it comes to the component in the direction of x2, and so forth. Also, if you ask the question how fast a component in the direction of v of x2 disappears from v1, that's dictated by the absolute value of lambda 2 divided by lambda 1, and so forth. Now, it's actually more beneficial to look at this backwards. If you ask the question, how fast does the component in the direction of xm minus 1 disappear from any arbitrary of these vectors, let's say v0, that is actually dictated by the ratio between lambda m minus 1 divided by lambda 0 in absolute value. That's how fast the component in the direction of xm minus 1 disappears from the vector v0. That's the constant that showed up in the convergence analysis. Okay? How fast xm minus 1 disappears from the vector in the direction of v1 is dictated by this ratio, lambda m minus 1 over lambda 1, and so forth. Importantly, if you ask the question of how fast the component in the direction of xm minus 1 disappears from the vector vm minus 2, that is dictated by this coefficient, lambda m minus 1 divided by lambda m minus 2. Now, where have we seen that before? We saw that show up in the convergence of the inverse power method. And then we said, oh, if we know a value that's close to the smallest eigenvalue, then we can accelerate that by subtracting off a shift as we do our inverse iteration that is close to lambda m minus 1. And then we said, oh, and we can come up with what that shift is by saying, oh, we have an approximation for the eigenvector associated with the smallest eigenvalue, and we can then use the Rayleigh quotient to actually compute that shift, an approximation for lambda n minus 1. And then we say, well, if we computed a hat along the way, if you think about it carefully, it is the m minus 1 entry in this matrix A hat that is exactly equal to the Rayleigh quotient computed with V m minus 1. Ah, and since A hat is equal to the A that is being computed here, which after all ends up converging to a diagonal matrix with all of the eigenvalues along its diagonal, and the last one would be lambda m minus 1, what that means is that, hey, we can look at that matrix that shows up in the QR algorithm we can pick out the bottom right entry out of that matrix, and we can use it to shift it. So what do we get then? We get an algorithm where we say, compute the QR factorization of A minus alpha m minus 1 times the identity. This is the entry in the lower right-hand corner of our matrix A. That's converging to lambda m minus 1. And then we simply set our next matrix A equal to R times Q, where we have to add back in alpha m minus 1 times the identity. Okay, and if we do that, then we have something that's known as the shifted QR algorithm. It has the benefit that we end up homing in on that last eigenvector very, very quickly. We saw that when we looked at carefully at the Rayleigh quotient iteration. That's how quickly we will get that eigenvector. And therefore, we will at least find one of the eigenvalues and corresponding eigenvector very quickly. What that doesn't help us with is the cost of each iteration. It also means that once we have actually found that eigenvalue and corresponding eigenvector, maybe we should do something with matrix A so that we don't keep going after that particular eigenvalue and eigenvector quickly. But now we have yet another small step towards what will become a very practical algorithm.